Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. Thank you for downloading. And thank you for subscribing to the latest edition of the 12 Kyle podcast. I am your boy, 12 Kyle. Man, check this out. On this episode, we are taking it back. We're going to talk about one of the most, probably arguably one of the greatest and maybe misunderstood, maybe underrated, maybe overrated rap labels ever. We are talking about the almighty Death Row, the rise and fall of Death Row Records. And listen, I couldn't get anybody else on this podcast to talk about this episode, about this subject, without getting these two gentlemen on here. My first guest is no stranger to the show. You guys have seen him on here. He represents the east side of LA. He has two podcasts, not one, but two. Open Run with BTG and Baylor the Great for President, BTG for President. You know him. You love him. Baylor is back in the building. BTG, what up, man?
Hey, 12 Cal, that money that you sent through, they said it was too much money. So you got to like break it down in like three different payments. They said the amount that you sent, the amount that you donated, you got to break it down in like three different transfers. Because it was, they flagged it. FBI, CIA, X-Men, all of that shit.
We doing this tonight, man.
Don't
show out in front of company, man. And my next guest, speaking of money, I mean, listen, I'm not even going to say much anymore about money. He is the host of the Too Much Game podcast. You've seen him on here before. My man, Uncle Dolemite, is back in the building. Dolly, what up?
Good evening, motherfuckers and motherfuckers. What's going on, 12 Kyle? The richest podcaster in the world.
Man, bro. This guy, boy.
Wealth personified.
Somebody's gonna believe y'all one day. One day, somebody's
because it's the truth. Gonna
believe y'all, but it ain't gonna be today.
He gonna change his name to 12B for listen, $12 billion.
I wanted to get you guys on here. Listen, boy, I tell you, with friends like this, you don't need enemies. I wanted to get you guys on, man, so we could get on here and talk about Death Row Records. The rise and fall of Death Row Records. Unbeknownst to a lot of people, Death Row Records is still a thing. Honestly, before I started even kind of getting the idea, I went and actually looked it up. Death Row actually still has a website. And it's being run by Snoop at this current time that we're talking. But the original Death Row Records started back in 1991. Dr. Dre, of course, Suge Knight, Dick Griffey. I did not know Dick Griffey, the legendary Dick Griffey, was an investor in Death Row. So I guess where I want to start with you guys, and I'll start first with you, Baylor. When you think of Death Row, if somebody says Death Row Records, what's the first thing you think about?
Suge Knight, off top. Suge Knight and the Death Row chain. Can you hear me?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I was going to say, I see 12 Kyle nod.
What about you, Dolan?
Oh, yeah, shit, I got you, me? Oh, okay. Shit. The birth of G-Funk. Like, a lot of what the West Coast sound like is from what they started.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd agree too. I think when somebody says Death Row, I think of that image, the logo first and foremost, and then I think of Suge Knight pulling on a big cigar. You know what I'm saying? Just that was just the look like that he gave. I think those images, everything that you guys mentioned and what I mentioned too as well, is very apropos because Death Row was a staple in the 90s as far as hip hop was concerned. They created a sound and fear, and we'll talk about that in a few, all across rap. And I think one of the reasons why I wanted to get you guys on is to have your perspective because I am 10 years older than both of you. So I know what I heard and I didn't really see much because we didn't have the internet, you know, in the 90s or whatever. But I know what I heard about Death Row and what I, you know, the stories and legendary recording sessions and all of this stuff like that, and the people that came in and out, people that were on the label. But I wanted to definitely get you guys' perspective, because you guys, you know, having grown up and lived out there, maybe you may have seen or heard different things. As far as artists, before we even get like deep into it, let's just start with the surface stuff. As far as artists, who is your Dolemite? Who is your favorite artist on Death Row, and why?
Honestly, I have to say Snoop, because to me, Doggy Style is the greatest album of all time. Like, I fuck with Thriller, you know, like it's certain albums that I fuck with, but nigga, Doggy Style is something different, dog. Like, I remember when that shit came out. Like, I remember my first time, and it was funny, the first time I heard that album, I was on Crenshaw in my dad lowrider. Like, we was on the Shaw, and literally every car up and down Crenshaw was playing that shit. So it's Snoop Dogg. I think 12.
What about you, Baylor? Collect.
Mine would be well, just like how he said with Doggy Style, my favorite album was Dog Food. You know what I'm saying? I looked at Daz and Corrupt. They was like, y'all remember Rockers? I remember Shawn Michaels and
Marty Jannetty.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, that was my favorite album right there. It's probably in my top five all time.
I get that, because wow,
that's what's up.
When dog food dropped, that was another
that was
one
a cold
of them,
ass like, album.
Go ahead, talk. Twitter guy got a cold delay, dog.
Oh yeah, no doubt. No. Go ahead. You got it.
Nah,
go ahead, Dolemite. You got it.
You got a delay.
You got a delay.
Like,
yeah,
I
know.
Kyle, I can tell. Via satellite, dog.
Wow. yeah, on satellite, on my own show. Yeah, my favorite artist, I definitely say was Snoop. Snoop was he was just different, man. I mean, like, and you mentioned like the Doggy Style album. That album, not only was it cold, but I just remember probably one of my main memories from that album was the buzz around the album. I mean, he had the, you know, deep cover, and so like the buzz was crazy, and so like they put, I remember the release date, it was supposed to come out like on a Tuesday, and they pushed it up to like Friday. And I just remember going to the store in the Prince of Orange Mall in Orangeburg, South Carolina, where I went to South Carolina State, and we got to the mall, and the mall was closed, and there was a line out the door, down the street, and like around a corner. And I was like, man, all these people, everybody was there for it, because the store opened at midnight so you could get the Doggy Style album. And we cut the line or whatever, but it was a man, listen, it was crazy, because again, what I want to kind of paint the picture of is that, particularly for somebody who's listening who wasn't around back then, like if you didn't get that Doggy Style album the week that it came out, you might not ever get it. Like you would have had to wait till at least like a week or two, because stores only got but so many, you know. So the Best Buys and place like that, you know, Sam Goody, Tower Records, they got more, but you know, depending on where you bought it from, you may have to wait if you didn't get it when the first day that it came out. So the buzz was just crazy, man. I really love that album, and it's an album I still bump to this day. What other albums? I know you mentioned Dog Food, Baylor. What other albums would you say, like, just Death Row releases that really just stood out to you, like your favorites as far as Death Row records?
I mean, shoot, outside of Snoop and the Dog Pound, I mean, you can't help but to bring up Pac. You know what I'm saying? Pac and whatever Dre got his fingers on at the time. So, And it was different. It was different because when the height of the, or I wouldn't say the height of it, but the beginning of the beef, it seemed like from the moment the beef was on, prior to that, everything was just equal with me. I was listening to Redman. I was listening to Wu-Tang a little bit. Didn't really understand them, but I listened to them. I messed with Redman a little bit more. and a couple of other cats from the East Coast. But, you know, once that switch hit on, it was just like a different, the city was just different.
Yeah, and like with me, of course, all eyes on me. That shit was a game changer.
Yeah.
And shit, like, you know, like you said, and it was funny because Warren G wasn't even signed to Death Row, but we associated him with Death Row.
Mm-hmm.
Like he had that same sound.
Right.
So you know, when his album dropped, it's fucked up that I can't remember the name of it, because I used to play that motherfucker all the time when he was, you know, leaning on the street sign. Like, that album was crazy. Like, everything that was coming from around they camp. Cause I even remember that Dre produced the Firm album and it was written. So just everything that they touched was banging. And it was a trip because, you know, I was on the Eazy-E side of things, as you know, Baylor could tell, because he'd been to my house. You see, I got the Eazy-E picture on my wall. They shot the diss song, Real Compton City G's, in front of my uncle's house. So as much as I didn't like them niggas as people, they music was so dope, you had to fuck with it.
Now that's interesting. So, okay, so let's go back a little bit. So, of course, we know that, you know, Dre was with Eazy, the NWA, Straight Outta Compton, crazy album. Well, first Eazy Does It, which came out first, and then Straight Outta Compton, both 88 classics, in my opinion, I think helped molded what we know as West Coast music. I won't say it started gangster rap or anything like that. I'll just say it helped mold the fit that we thought was gangster rap. So as far as the beef that Eazy and Dre had, were people like siding out there from what you can remember, or at least from what maybe people, older people were talking about?
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it favored us though. I mean, you know, I'll put it to you like this. I was still listening to the music, but I was against Bad Boy for sure.
He talking about the Eazy-E beef though.
Oh, which the Ruthless
Records.
Oh, well, look,
let me I'm talking Eazy-E, yeah.
Oh, I stayed out of that.
I was literally in that perfect. Like, I'm cool with BG Knockout. So like in the song, What Would You Do, when Dad said fuck BG Knockout and everybody down with him, we took that shit personal. And the crazy thing is yeah, BG Knockout caught a body behind that shit. He ended up in prison for some years. I think he just got out like about, wow,
didn't know that,
about a decade ago, but he did about 10 to 15 behind that shit. Cause you know, the Ruthless Records versus Death Row, that niggas wasn't playing about that shit. We like they music, but we ain't like them niggas.
Wow. That's crazy when you think about it, because like, you know, where we stood, we didn't know any, I mean, we knew that there was tension between obviously Death Row and Ruthless, but you know, from what we heard, it was all on wax, you know, and we didn't know much about any threats or anything like that. Of course, you know, we heard rumors, and then, you know, you heard the stuff about Shug or whatever like that, and Shug became this mythical figure, you know, in hip hop. But I mean, like, even if you go back a little bit further, when you start thinking about like some of the albums that got released on Death Row, you talk about The Chronic, Doggy Style, Dog Fool, All Eyes on Me, the Don Columinati Theory, even some of the soundtracks like the Above the Rim soundtrack, Murder Was the Case soundtrack, just to name a few. I mean, like, those were some, I don't want to say classic albums, but I mean, but like,
they were classic,
incredible albums, right? And then so you have this underlying, I mean, well, you know, I try not to throw the word classic around, but I love all of those albums. And so you got that, but then you have this underlying bubbling thing that's going on in a power struggle within Death Row as well between Dre and Suge. So Dolemite, my next question I want to throw to you. Okay. How can I put this? Since in your organization, how was it that Suge was able to bring together Bloods and Crips? Because Blood, how was he able to bring his faction and the Crips together and everybody mesh under that umbrella and be successful, keeping it music and not street?
Most of the street motherfuckers in that label was Bloods. Like Snoop Dogg was a Crip, you know, Nate Dogg and them, like they was Crips, but they was almost like employees. But everybody who was like down with Death Row on the street angle of it, they was all Mob Pie Rules. So it wasn't like he had this united front of Crips and Bloods. It was more like, nigga, do you want your bag or do you want to be next to a bunch of Crips? Like, you got to fall in line with what's going on. So it wasn't even that it was no super unity, because, you know, with the stories that were told, niggas was getting in squabbles in that studio regularly because of shit like that. So, yeah, niggas got along for the sake of the bag, but it was definitely tension in that motherfucker. But, you know, yeah. Niggas wanted their bread.
I think there's an interview out there with Daz talking about how, you know, they everybody on the same level, but there was still a division, you know what I'm saying? Because of the street politics or whatever. So they had, you know, I'm pretty sure they was outnumbered, you know what I mean? But still, I think they had one of the most popular acts on the label, which is Snoop, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, that's his homies. Which is, I was talking to Dolemite last weekend, and I was like, Two Fly was my son's 707 coach. And then I realized the whole coaching staff was Dog Pound. Was Dog Pound. You know, so I could be a little bit biased.
Yeah. You know, and that's the thing, like, me and Baylor both kind of got tied.
You know, that's interesting because it's like, when you think about it, go ahead, Dolemite.
No, go ahead, do your thing. You got a delay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so what I was going to ask was, like, you know, when you look at the where everything is kind of crossing, there is ties that are crossing, you know what I'm saying, where, you know, you got one guy over here, and it's like you said, do you want to make money, or you want to, you know, go to war with each other? So I guess the thing that always kind of was mind-boggling to me was, and Baylor, I'll start with you, how do you think Suge was able to bring all of this together? Because he wasn't somebody that, like, went to college. He had worked in the industry, but he wasn't an industry guy. He was a guy that came up from the streets. How do you think about it? Because people, depending on where you are and who you are and where you are in life, you know, people have one way or another they feel about Suge Knight. I mean, like, they either love him. I don't know anybody's like, oh, yeah, Suge, okay. You know, nobody says that about him. So my question is, you know, how do you think he was able to pull all that together?
Well, we don't have too many examples of cats that was in that position who did go to college, though. You know what I'm saying? Some of these infamous record labels was built off the back of some street cats, or was funded by some real street cats. You know what I mean? So I think he just, he had the name where I'm assuming, I can't tell you facts, but I'm assuming he had a name and his. Well, see, there you go.
Suge Knight wasn't he wasn't really a street dude. Like Suge Knight, he went to UNLV as a football player.
He did.
Like he got his name up off of being, NWA's bodyguard for a while.
And Bobby.
And also his association to Harry O, which was, the bigger investor in Death Row Records. Like Harry O had a whole lot to do with that. Like even with the street cred that Suge Knight got, like of course he gained his street cred through, knocking niggas out and getting niggas knocked out. So his street cred built through the industry, not as much before. But a lot of what it was that, as far as like really what helped him get everybody together, was his business acumen. Like he was always a good businessman. He was always a hustler. So he had the ability to basically put into everybody's mind, like you said earlier, 12 Cal, do you want this bag or do you want this beef? Like, nigga, you gotta choose one. Like, y'all niggas gonna have to coexist at least somewhat in order for us to get this money. So even if y'all gotta go in the back and get some fisticuffs, we still gonna get in here and make this music.
And he getting cast out of contract. So
you mentioned you mentioned Easy earlier. Which is where I'm going. You mentioned Easy earlier, Dolemite. Let's just say, for the sake of saying, Easy lives, doesn't pass away from HIV. Could Ruthless and Death Row could have coexisted at the rate that they were, I guess, that they were going, if Eazy-E had lived?
Yeah, but there was going to be casualties, probably on both sides.
Yeah.
Because like that, like I said earlier, that beef wasn't just on wax. I don't know if you heard about the Something for the Honeys video shoot where BG Knockout and Dresta ran into them niggas, and you see Nate Dogg hitting Drace over the head with that golf club. Like,
golf club, yeah.
Them niggas wasn't playing. So it was a situation where if Easy wouldn't have died, it could have went stronger with Ruthless Records, because like one thing I didn't like about the NWA movie, like I tell people, the less you know about the situation, the more entertaining the movie is. Because if you was really there for that, you realize that movie was full of bullshit. Because like if you watch the movie and you see like Easy was going broke, he was downgrading houses, he was back selling weed, that's bullshit. Around that time that they said that Easy E was falling off, he had fucking Bone Thugs and Harmony. Easy E never fell off. Like remember, he had Bone Thugs and Harmony. He also discovered the Black Eyed Peas. Like in no context was Easy falling off in no way. So if Ruthless would have stayed cracking, shit, Ruthless would be a huge label right now. Yeah. I think honestly they probably would have pushed each other to be bigger than they was. But knowing Suge, Death Row probably would have fell off any fucking way. And you never know, Snoop would have probably fell off Ruthless. Matter of fact, Snoop and Dre, because on some real shit, if they was able to get their business together and, bury the hatchet and, like, really be able to get the monies to make sense, we could have saw NWA come back together.
Man, that would have been crazy.
That would have been insane. What about you, Baylor?
As far as what? What was the question?
If Easy,
I mean, as far as like what Dolemite was, if Easy was still alive.
Oh man, I think the whole rap game would be different. Like that whole butterfly effect. You know what I mean? Because I'm thinking the two cats that we have. If you talk to a lot. And I sent you a video too, 12 Cal. But if you've noticed, I don't want to take too much from that video, because it was a bunch of youngsters or even people that wasn't even from here that was just throwing out names. But across the board, if you talk to cats that's really from here, you're not gonna get past number one and number two and not say Nip and Eazy-E. And that goes beyond, you know what I'm saying, the booth. You know what I'm saying? We're talking about changing the streets of LA, you know? So, I mean, we got, it took us this long to get an artist like Nip to change that, but Eazy charisma in the city was just, it was unmatched. You know what I'm saying? We're talking about, you know, it's Michael Jackson and then him. You know what I mean? That's who he was. So, it probably changes the sound of the West Coast a little bit. You know, I mean, we shared a spotlight in the early 2000s with the Bay Area. There's no telling where the rap game would have went on the West Coast if Eazy was still alive. I see a lot of more. It's a lot of more gangster music in the future. That's for sure.
Oh, you already know that. that actually leads me to another point I want to make. The three of us, huge sports fans. There's a term in sports called a free agent. So. A free agent we know can make or break a team. A free agent can go and be on a team and bring other free agents and win championships. We ain't gonna talk about that. So my question is, in theory, Suge Knight brought in two free agents. Mm-hmm. Dr. Dre, Tupac. Which free agent do you think was more important to Death Row? Dr. Dre or Tupac? Baylor, you go first.
Dre.
Shit. That's a good ass question. I would have to say, I don't even think there's a right or wrong answer if you say either one, because Dre had the sound, but Tupac was a one-man army. Man, that's a tough one. I mean, I could say Pac brought more attention to the label. You know what I mean? Especially where, and it was organic because of where he's from originally. You know what I mean? That's why he's bumped down on the list after so many decades, really. I would definitely say I probably got to go with Pac only because the other coast was paying attention to us a little bit more because of him.
I got Dre. Mm-hmm. Because I feel like without Dre, there'd be no Death Row.
I think. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, like Dre. Fact. Without Dre, there's no Doggy Style. Without Dre, there's no Chronic. Without Dre, the above the rim soundtrack don't sound how it sound. Without them Dre beats, it wouldn't have been All Eyes on Me. Like, Pac was a beast, don't get me wrong, but when you put Pac on them Dre beats, that shit was different. It was a whole different fucking sound. Like, we got a whole different Pac. Like, California Love, To Live and Die in LA, like, that was Dre. Like, Pac was Pac before Dre, but Pac was a whole different Pac after Dre. So yeah. I would have to say Dre.
Max. Yeah, I gotta say Dre. I mean, it is a tough question. And actually, that was actually the question that started my idea about this podcast, because, you know, I think both of them are essential, but Dre was part of the foundation. And I think, you know, much like Dolemite just said, like, if you don't have Dre, the Chronic set it off. I mean, like, the Chronic was the springboard to Snoop's career. It was the springboard to us, you know, being introduced, at least for people like me, introduced to the Dog Pound, Lady of Rage, RBX, all everybody else that dropped on that album, that would drop subsequent albums, you know, they were introduced to a lot of us through that particular album. And if you don't have Dre, I mean, he's the engineer. And then Doggy Style was, you know, and people still go back and forth about which one was better, Doggy Style or the Chronic. I that's a question I can't answer, because I love both of them. I can't even really differentiate between the two. And I know it's people have their favorites. But yeah, it's that both of those guys are really important, because like Dolemite said, Pac was one way before he got to Death Row. Then he comes to Death Row, and keep in mind, his time on Death Row really wasn't that long, a couple of years max. And you saw what he did. So the next question I got for you guys, and I'll start first with you, Dolemite. Did Tupac's death, was that the beginning of the end of Death Row?
Yes. Like, it was already starting to decline, because just like you heard on Toss It Up, like, he was already dissing Dre. Like, Dre was already on his way out. Like, shit was already fucking up. Mm-hmm. But, like, his death was literally the nail in the coffin, because I feel like if, let's hypothetically say he stay alive and he stay with Death Row, because, you know, there was a rumor that a part of the reason he's dead is because he was planning on leaving Death Row. But let's just hypothetically say he meant to stay.
Yep.
He would have been able to keep them lights on at Death Row for however long he wanted to, honestly. So if he stays on that label can't go nowhere. Like, it's like if you sign Drake or you sign Jay-Z, like, as long as they making music, your lights stay on. You know, so if he'd have stayed, then, you know, even with all the turmoil, even with Dre leaving, even if Snoop would have left, that nigga could have held that label by his damn self. So, yeah, he was the nail in the coffin.
What about you, Baylor?
Same. I mean, we talking about, this is like, oh man, I know I'm about to get some backlash when I say this. This is like putting Michael Jordan on the lake. This is like Michael Jordan on the Lakers, and then, you know, he end up retiring or something like that.
Come on, man.
Yeah, no, that was the end of it, man. Once Pac went down, I think at that point, right after, we started to get like a plethora of East Coast artists started to come out a little bit more. You had the rise of DMX. And even, I know it's going to be funny, but Ja Rule was on his way and things like that. But I think because of Pac's death,
right,
that turned the whole rap game around. So let alone the fall of Death Row, the whole rap game kind of changed. I think the door opened for other artists to get in that we probably wouldn't see if Pac was still alive. With how we talk about if EZ was still alive, I don't think we see certain artists come out. You know what I mean? So yeah, it was definitely it was a direct fall after that.
Yeah, because the West Coast literally fell off after that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the only thing we had after that was West Side Connection.
You could tell that there was a shift.
Yeah.
Yeah. How was it? And I know, again, I was older than you guys, so if I want to say when Pac died, I was probably like 23, so that would have made y'all 13. So I don't know how y'all can answer this, but answer as best as you can. How was it as far as, from what you can remember, what you heard, how was it as far as moving around out there? Because like, and this is gonna make y'all laugh, I just remember literally hearing artists, rappers from the East Coast on the radio saying, yeah, we can't go to LA. We can't go to LA. LA can't come out here. How was it as far as like moving around? I know it wasn't no problem for y'all because y'all live there, but do you remember hearing anything about people coming out there or artists coming out there, anything like that, being trying to get extra security, all kind of stuff like that?
Nah, not from my knowledge. We wasn't getting information like, we didn't have Twitter back then, so we didn't know what them niggas was saying back there. You know what I mean? But as a 13-year-old, my mind wasn't really on that. It was a shock. It was like a culture shock when I got the word. I remember I was in my living room, and I got the message. I was like, damn. But like I said on one of my episodes when I was talking about Nip, the impact of his death was much greater than when Pac died. I think one, because I was young, I was 13. And then I think Pac's death was the first, that was like my first encounter losing an artist like that, if I'm not mistaken. You know what I mean? Like Columbine, the shooting. That was my first time ever hearing about or witnessing a school shooting. So it was like, I didn't really know how to react to that. You know what I mean? I went to school. I was sad that he was gone, but not, I wasn't sad like when we lost Nip.
And see, like on our side.
Yeah.
Like when Pac passed away, because like I said, like, not that I was like really ingrained in the whole death row shit, but like I said, Drayster and BG Knockout is from my neighborhood. So it was a whole lot of rumblings of them bad boy niggas better stay where they at. Like they better not bring their dumb ass out here.
Mm.
Like when Biggie died, honestly, my first thought was, it's the fuck you get. Like, I ain't even gonna bullshit you. Like, as sad and as morbid as that sounds, like, nigga, you was at odds with the face of the West Coast at the time. And then this nigga passed away, and then, within some months, you out here partying. Like, nigga, the fuck you thought was gonna happen?
Yep.
And it's not even that I was happy that he died, yep. But at the same time, it kind of was like, nigga, what the fuck did you honestly think was gonna happen? Like, that's like some Atlanta niggas going to Chicago after King Von got killed. Like, nigga,
right.
Is you stupid?
Yeah.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah, that ain't what you wanna do. And that's the thing. It was it was even more heightened. I don't think it was that big. I mean, it was a big deal when Pac died, but they tried to kind of portray it as an isolated incident, but we knew, like, we heard, we didn't have Twitter, we didn't have, social media, anything like that. So, all we heard was what we heard. And what we heard, a lot of what we heard turned out to be true. A lot of it was rumor and speculation. Then when Biggie died, when Biggie got murdered, and given the fact that he was murdered out there, I distinctly remember artists being on the radio in New York City on Hot 97 saying, we can't go out there. We can't go out to LA, and LA rappers can't come out here because it's gonna be a problem. And so then they tried to get Farrakhan in and all of this other stuff. And this was at the quote unquote height of the beef, if you wanna call it a beef. But I think, those deaths were definitely significant. I remember where I was when we got the word that Pac died. I was at work and I just remember we had a radio at work and they played a Tupac song, and I walked outside and I came back inside and they were playing another song. I was like, that's weird. I was like, they don't normally play Tupac songs back to back. And then they played another Tupac song. I was like, they played Dear Mama. That was like the third song. And then the guy came on and said, we lost Tupac, so forth and so on. I was like, wow. I was like, I was in disbelief because that particular time you didn't lose people as far as rappers like that. But Death Row was Death Row took over rap, really. I mean, like, it literally had rap in a chokehold. when you, I guess the next question I had, I'll start first with you, Baylor. When you think about some of the songs from the death row artists, when you think about the music that came out on death row, like what are some of the joints, like even to this day, you put on and you just jammed
to New York. Out the gate, I still listen to New York, New York. I listen to that like it's an R&B song. I go up and down Crenshaw, you know, because I got a couple of clients that don't stay too far off of Crenshaw. I have my window all the way down. Ignite Volume, New York, New York. That's one of the smoothest. That's one of the smoothest rap songs of all time. So I play that one like, I mean, it's almost damn near an alarm clock for me.
With me, the whole Doggy Style album, especially like G's and Hustlers. Yeah. I think G's and Hustlers is like probably one of my favorite songs that came out of there. You Can't See Me by Tupac, 21 Gun Salute, Blasphemy. Like, it's a bunch of them because, like, you know, that was like my era, and I low key be playing catch up because, like I said, at the time I was on Eazy-E side of that beef, so a lot of that death row shit I didn't even want to hear it at the time. When it was like at its height and cracking, mm-hmm. It's like you couldn't help but to hear it because it was dope. But just off personal feelings of, you know, hearing the song, mm-hmm. What Would You Do, when the nigga saying fuck BG Knockout, like, nigga, that's my homeboy. What the fuck you mean? Yeah. Fuck BG Knockout and everybody down right. with him. Nigga, I'm down with him. Right. Nigga, you just said fuck me in a song. You know, so it kind of hit different. But like now at this time, you know, Daz and BG Knockout is cool. Like, you know, on phone call status. So, you know, mm-hmm. now I could listen to the music, you know, with objectivity and actually enjoy it, as opposed to back in the day when I was listening to that shit with a frown on my face, like, these bitch ass niggas going in.
You can listen to it like it's art now.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I could actually enjoy it. Where at the time, like, even when I heard Doggy Style, I said, this yeah. bitch ass nigga going.
Hell yeah. Yeah, man. For me, like you said, surprisingly, G's and Hustlers. Love that joint, man. I mean, it's almost, and I don't even know if Snoop freestyled it, but it sounds like a freestyle.
That's what you said.
It sounds about as close to a freestyle, I think, as you can get at particular, yeah, at somebody at that level. And I thought I heard him say something like that, but I wasn't sure if that was true or not. But yeah, Chronic, man, I mean, just about everything on the Chronic. I used to Dog Pound, Smooth, What Would You Do? That was my joint too as well. Sorry, BG, my bad. I used to pump that shit too. And even Pop. I'm not, and I've said this before on the podcast, and people get mad at me. I still maintain All Eyes on Me should have been one CD. If it's one CD, it could possibly be the greatest album ever. But when you go to, he went the double CD route, and it was a couple of filler songs on there, you know, songs they really didn't need. I get why they did it, but I mean, it is what it is. But it's Pop. I mean, I love Pop. But yeah, he had, they didn't, honestly, music wise, they didn't miss when they, in their run, the death row run that they had, they didn't miss. So that leads me to this next question, Baylor. I'll start with you. Suge Knight, where did he go wrong? I mean, because he's coming up in rap. He's a mogul. He's making money, you know, so all eyes on him, and he's got everything in his hands. And then he doesn't. Where do you think he went wrong?
Not seeing the bigger picture, but I mean, I just can't put that on him. I can think of a lot of other cats that was in his position with other record labels. They may not have done the same thing that he did, but they all have their individual faults on running that type of roster, a roster with depth. Greed, you know what I mean? At the end of the day, when you're trying to bully everybody, everybody either going to be scared of you or they're going to be your enemy, you know? And all these interviews that's coming out now on YouTube, a lot of these East Coast artists were admitting that they was afraid of them, you know? But at the same, we was a heavy influence. Like, the gang culture out here, which some of them still got it messed up, some of them learned the wrong way, but they looked at it as it was like a style. But this was like real life out here, you know what I mean? And they don't know the street politics, they didn't understand the street politics, it was just a lot of cats that made gain. I wouldn't necessarily say glorify, but you know, cats out here was living a truth, and the East Coast, you know, was attracted to it. I think he could have capitalized on it. You know what I'm saying? Especially with having the whole Death Row East, but it was just going the wrong way. But I mean, that's not just Suge though. That's the black culture in general. Mm-hmm. We don't know how to come together and unify for the bigger cause. To this day, we still having arguments about what was the biggest label. Death Row is always going to be in the mix, and Death Row could have even got bigger. As soon as you start signing cats from the East Coast, depending on who you sign, that's just going to make you even stronger. But it was just too much ego involved. So that's all it is. The rise and fall of everything is a man's ego.
Yeah, I feel like where Suge fucked up at was, He wanted to make it a mafia instead of a music label.
Yeah.
Like he didn't understand the balance of fear and respect. Like, of course, for a motherfucker to respect you, there has to be a level of fear. Like, they have to understand that you got the ability to punish them if they disrespect you. But he took that element way too far. Like, he was cool with the cigar and, you know, I got these street niggas with me, but he was overforcing his hand. Like, you know, like I said in the Suge Knight freestyle, the episode that I did, he was a king that was moving like a pawn. Like, when you a king, you don't be on the front line. When you a king, you don't put your hands on nobody. Like, nigga, you don't demonstrate, you delegate. But he was so busy trying to be the most feared motherfucking music. Like, if somebody respects you, they'll work with you. If somebody respects you, they'll work around you. But if somebody fears you, they'll try to eliminate you.
Yep.
So when you create this fear, everybody wants to knock you off, as opposed to, like, you know, other label heads like a Jay Prince. You know, motherfuckers feared him, but they also respected him. Like, you know, I understand that, you know, this motherfucker is a dangerous man.
Respect, right.
But he's a man of respect, not just a man of fear. But Suge Knight, on the other hand, like, Jamie Foxx had the perfect analogy for it. He was like, nigga, Suge Knight walk in the room, nigga, it's like a pit bull and don't nobody know the owner.
Yeah.
That's what Suge Knight was. Like, nigga, we don't know what this nigga might do. This nigga might whoop somebody's ass. It might be a shootout. Like, we don't know what's going to happen with this nigga around here. And it's like, that's bad for business. You know, like, that's bad for corporate and a lot of people that'll put money into your business. Mm-hmm. So a lot of where Suge Knight fucked up at was he stopped thinking like a label head and start trying to think like a gang leader.
Yeah.
And that's literally what got his ass locked up.
Man, not much more I can say after that, man. I mean, that's the truth. I mean, like, the opportunities were there, and, you know, he really just dribbled the ball off his foot. And I mean, like, you can't argue with the success that he had, but he could have taken that success and taken it to the next level. Like Baylor mentioned, you know, having Death Row East artists, you know, he's East Coast artists coming and signing with the Death Row label. I mean, like, he had ideas, you know, movies, other ventures and stuff like that. it just didn't pan out. And you know, now he's doing time, and I don't know if or when he's ever going to get out. But yeah, I had to bring you guys on, man. I wanted to talk about, you know, the almighty Death Row, because again, Death Row to me, regardless of what you think, and I grew up with a lot of people who used to be on, oh man, you listen to that West Coast music. This music to me helped mold the 90s. It helped mold hip hop. And I think it's just as important. I think Death Row's the contribution that Death Row made is just as important as the contribution that Bad Boy made. And you can make a case for either one, which one was more important. But I know people have their favorites. But for me, this music right here is special to me. This era was special to me. Death Row was special to me, not having grown up and seen it or knew anything about it, but just the music that it delivered was dope. So I wanted to take some time. And of course, there's going to be an episode about the rise and fall of Bad Boy as well, which should be interesting to say the least. But before we get out of here, man, you guys, again, I want to thank you guys for coming on. Like I said, I know it's been a delay in my headphones because my delay is crazier than yours because it's taking even longer for me to hear you guys. But I want to thank you guys for coming through. Definitely appreciate it. So before we get out of here, you guys can, Baylor, you can go first, tell folks where they can find you, where they can listen to your podcast, where they can cop and definitely cop merch from these guys. I personally have gotten merchandise from both Baylor and Dolemite. And, as he he flashes his, oh yeah. Okay. That's a Dolemite shirt. Okay, I mean, that's a Baylor shirt. And it's dope, man. It's dope. I ain't just blowing smoke. It's dope, and it feels good and it looks good. So go ahead and take it away, Baylor.
At Baylorism on Twitter, at Baylorism on TikTok, at Baylor the Great on IG. Yeah, and buy merch. And all of my merch ain't for sale, but some of it is. And just pay me, and then I'll make it, and then I'll send it to you. Just do that. Just don't ask me no questions. I'll do that.
Stupid. What about you, Dolemite?
Follow me on Instagram at Uncle Dolemite or Too Much Game Podcast. I record on Sundays live. So when I'm recording my show, if you want to get involved around 2:30 p.m. Pacific time or possibly later than that, because, you know, I record when I feel like it. In the evening time or in the afternoon on Sundays, be ready. I'm going to be live on Instagram on my personal page or on my podcast page. I'm also on YouTube at Too Much Game Podcast. T-O-O Much Game Podcast. Ain't no number two in that shit because I'm number one.
Well, I forgot to mention my goddamn show.
Go ahead, nigga. Do it now while 12 Kyle is on delay.
Mention the show now. Yeah.
BTG for President, Open Room with BTG, part of the Rare Sounds Network, Black Horror Humor, and that's it. Oh, and the Breaks Radio. I'm tripping. The Breaks Radio, too. I'm talking about the culture as well. Yo, and don't think I didn't see that, too. Diddy paid that bill real fast. He settled out of court. I seen that. Speaking of Bad Boy. And that's a pun.
Say what? What happened?
It is.
He paid. Wow. From the lawsuit that old girl just filed.
Yeah, I see that 30 tickets.
Wow. Mm-hmm. That was quick.
Yeah, it's Christmas time.
Smart man.
Wow, that was quick. Hey man, when the details come out, man, you sometimes you can't afford it. You can't afford for the truth to come out. You can't afford for the truth to come out. So it kind of is what it is. But don't believe the hype. Hey, that Bad Boy podcast is still coming. Please believe it. You guys been listening for a long time. I hope you know where you can find me. You can find the 12 Kyle podcast anywhere you get podcasts. We have a YouTube channel. Check me out. Follow me on the socials at 12 Kyle across the board if you want to contribute and donate some money to this broke podcaster. $TWELVEKYLE. That's going to do it for us. So for my man Dolemite of the 12 Kyle podcast, we'll catch you guys next time. 5